Title of her song, Going Nowhere, but that's certainly not true of Lena Zavaroni.
I was watching the other night, Wednesday night, was it, when you brought the television series to an end, that was the last one. Whenever I see you, it makes me think of my early boyhood, you know, two or three years ago, when the big thing in life was to take, or one of the big things for me was to take the old paddle steamer, which I don't think they exist anymore, but from Largs on the Asia coast across to the Isle of Bute and Rosse. Rosse, where you grew up.
That's right, yeah.
Which seemed a magic place to me then, you know. But it's a very insular spot, and it's very cut off. And I just think that when you were 9 years old, you know, and you went for the fondling.
Oh, well, I mean, at the time, I couldn't believe that, you know, I'd sort of, like, come from a little island into a big city. And, I mean, there's no traffic lights on the island, and tons of traffic lights when I came here. I couldn't believe it. I really couldn't. And at the time, I just thought everything was like a big game, really, you know.
Yeah.
I didn't really take it that seriously.
What about places like Soho? I mean, did you visit Soho?
Oh, Soho. Well, I got a funny story there. I remember I was walking down Soho, I think it was with my manager and my father, and I was...
Oh, he came with you?
Yes, that was right. He sort of, you know, my parents came up with me just for the beginning. And we're walking down Soho, and I was amazed. I mean, I looked up and all these rude pictures, you know, I really... And I was sort of saying, Dad, don't look, you know. Sort of trying to get up to his eyes. And I couldn't believe it, you know.
Now, Zavaroni. Zavaroni is that good old Scotch name. It has a nice Celtic ring to it. It was very common on the Isle of Bute these days, they tell me.
Yeah, well, it still is. How that come about? You see, my grandfather's Italian, and that's why I've got an Italian name, you know. And at the very beginning, when my grandfather sort of, he came over from Italy and sort of during the war and settled on the island, and he sort of began to make business, sort of selling ice cream, making Italian ice cream, and then sort of started getting little factories together on the island, and then sort of he began to get little shops, and so there's tons of shops all around the island called Zavaroni. So it's sticking out as soon as you hit the, island on the.
Well, ferry. Which are run by members of the family, are they?
Yes.
I mean,
oh,
he did colonise the place.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, it's
typical Italian.
Yeah.
What are your?
I don't know, really. I remember that I used to go enter for talent competitions, you know, when I was about six and that. Every year there used to be a talent competition on the island.
But the family itself was musical, wasn't
oh,
just
yes.
You?
Oh, the whole family. I mean, I can remember singing from I was, goodness, knee-high to adult. I mean, I still am, but, you know. I can remember always singing because my parents sung, my mother and my father sings, and the whole family sung, you know, just a complete musical background, and I think that's just why I'm...
But I just wondered, did you ever think at that time that you might one day be part of what must have seemed a very glossy and glittery thing on the, the television box in the sitting room?
Oh, no, I never thought that, never.
Because the first time that I saw you was when you were about this high.
Yes.
And you were on the Huey Green Opportunity Knocks thing, and you won that about 5 weeks in succession, didn't you? And it was then that you made the decision, or I assume your parents made the decision, to try for a life in show business, and you moved from there, and they stayed there. This is the point, an agent, whatever. Yes. Did you realise what that entailed until you did it?
Well, when I first went to London, I thought, well, I'm going to see my mum and dad. I thought every day, well, you know, every couple of days or whatever. I didn't have a clue that, I'd be sort of gone and I wouldn't see them for a long time. But at the beginning, I was just so, I don't know, taken aback by everything. And I really sort of, I don't know, everything I did, like there was cameras and things, I was so frightened. But I got used to it all, I got used to everything. And then after a while I sort of appreciated really sort of going to see my parents and that. And
I just wonder, you know, I wonder if you will ever reach a point in life when you look back with a certain kind of regret and think, you know, I had no adolescence, you know, I went from the age of 9 or 10 and suddenly I was a grown-up, I had to make a living.
Well, I mean, I really did sacrifice some things, but what I really wanted to do, what I was doing at the time, I couldn't have cared less, you know, if I didn't sort of go out to play a lot or whatever, because my playing time was when I was on the stage performing, and I just loved it, and I mean, I still do.
A bit like a fairy tale, I must have seen to you.
Yeah, well, suppose.
Yeah. I mean, the reason herself was a child star, and then later in life found it difficult to cope emotionally with some of the pressures there, and I mean, you yourself were ill, and the newspapers at least made it sound as though that was a direct consequence, you know, the pressures of the kind of life that you were living, the show business life.
Yeah. I mean, I don't... Yes, some sort of newspapers can sort of, you know, maybe get the wrong idea or whatever, but I don't know, I never really...
I mean, you don't think it was that, do you?
Not at all, really. I mean, I love to sing and I love to do my work, and I don't really feel as if I've got that many, you know.
It's just that problems. I was watching the other night, for example. You know, you're 17 now.
Yeah.
I mean, when I was 17, I was climbing trees. and there you were with all the guest artists and the dancers, you know, and the musicians. I mean, you must feel sometimes when you go on and think, I've got to make this come together tonight. This is all for me, and somehow I've got to pull this in, you know, and bring it all back home.
Oh, yeah, I know what you mean, but I mean, if I really do think like that, I sort of... That's not the way I sort of look at it. I just sort of... I go on, and if I worry too much, if I really do worry too much, then I know that when I'm on stage, if I worry too much, I know I'll get everything wrong. But I just go out there and I think, well, I get it wrong, you know, I get it wrong.
And you can switch it off like that?
Yes, I just sort of... It just sort of goes through.
I was watching you once warming seals, and you were tossing these, tossing hoops to them, you know. And the amazing thing was, I mean, you got it right every time. Now, I know what it's like working with animals. It's so unpredictable.
But you don't know. Oh, I'll tell you this one. When I was doing that show, I was sort of dressed up as a clown, and we had to throw, like, hoops to the seals. And it was ever so difficult. I mean, we took take after take after take.
Oh, so it wasn't as easy. It wasn't straightforward.
Well, not really. No, it wasn't. And this went on for quite a long time, you know. And we'd taken ages to go over this number. We'd taken all day to get it really perfect. And we'd finished it. And they said, right, everybody, we want to wait until we've got a clear. That means until everything's, they checked everything to see if it's okay. So they let the seals go, actually, because the seals went off sort of home. And they checked the tape back, and the tape had been completely wrong, you know. There's something wrong with the machine. And they said, oh, you know, we've got to get everybody back, but the seals had gone. So what they did was that they said, we've got to send out a message to Capital Radio saying that if anybody sees a seals in their car at the back of a van, would you please ring up the BBC?
Well, they got them back anyhow. They got them back in time. Now, listen, on Wednesday, you finished your whole series with a nice song. I gather it's your latest song.
Actually, I'm quite sort of excited about it because Marvin Hamlisch sort of wrote it and produced it and that, and he came over specially for me, so I'm really sort of, you know, excited about it, and I hope it does well.
Well, we're going to hear it now. Ladies and gentlemen, Lena Zavaroni.
So here I am, alone again, not at all like I thought that I would be. Yes, I lost my way. Hey, somebody promised me the sunshine. Somebody promised me the moon. Somebody told me there'd be roses and rainbows. It's okay to be lonely now and then. Open up your eyes.